And let's see. Let's give this a try. So I'm going to give this about 30 seconds, and you should be able to provide an answer, and we'll have a little bit of fun with it. Wow, you guys are quick. All right, 80% of you voted. It's pretty high. And let's take a look. Here was our reply. So 81% of you had watched my video. So that tells me I probably shouldn't play it again. And 14% haven't watched it. I would really, really would ask you to. And the 1% or 5% that haven't yet, you know, you've got some time on your hands, and I would suggest you go through it. It's about 16 minutes long. And then, yes, but I fell asleep. Nobody answered that. So very happy. Anyway, let's get rocking and rolling, shall we? So today we're going to talk a little bit about the market updates. We're going to talk about some of the government subsidies and also some other updates that we have. And in order to do that, I just want to go through a little bit of housekeeping. I think most of you know who I am, and it's always important that we understand. There's one thing I would like to highlight, and that is part of being in this business, if you do not have a certified financial planner degree or you are not working on it, then it is just not going to be possible to continue to function, because it's important that clients receive all of the information that they can regarding tax planning, will and estate planning, not just investment planning, but all of the integration of that, which we call a financial plan. And I think that you'll see. I'd like to introduce you to a few team members if you haven't met them yet. So Bernard has been with us for a while now. Some of you may have spoken with him or you've interacted with him, which is wonderful. And also a new member that has just joined our team in the last little while. I did not have time to send out a proper invite or dedication to Marivic and give you an introduction to her. But Marivic and Mark, if you look down in the lower center, is our mortgage planning specialist. Both Marivic and Mark moved here from Calgary, and they joined the office in around mid-February. And that was when Marivic then was started to transition into being an associate consultant on our team as well. We also have a new wealth planning specialist, Kevin. Kevin is moving here from Guelph, but he's in transit is what I would say. He can't move. And then Olga is our insurance specialist. Some of you may have met her in the past, but she is a dynamic member of our team. Now, as you know, I don't just work alone. I don't just work with our team. It's impossible to know everything. So I am supported by a very large advanced financial planning group. Christine Van Kalmba has over 23 years of experience. 2018, she was voted as the top tax and estate planning lawyer in the country. So whenever it comes to will planning, the person I go to directly or trusts is Christine, without question. And Jack is very instrumental in helping, in particular when it comes to cross-border issues or business successions and philanthropic planning and corporate planning. So that's where Jack and Christine come in. Together, they run a team of about 35, but they're really my go-tos. So one thing I just wanted to remind you of, and one thing I'm very grateful for, as you know, is this: we've been having this evolution towards asset management, and it's really succinct today with new managers being added. China AMC is one of them. Wellington is another. You can see in the top center. But right now, 5 of the 7 largest asset manager in the world are being utilized within your portfolios. Their ability to share information is phenomenal. So to put it into perspective, as you know, I've talked about BlackRock because they're the number one largest in the country or in the world today. But BlackRock, which manages close to $6 trillion US, is one company, and compared to the marketplace in Canada, which hovers a little bit over 2.3 trillion total. So BlackRock in itself is almost 3 times the size of the entire investment landscape in Canada. Phenomenal. Just a quick reminder, where I think that we fit is with you only. We sit beside you. And unlike other companies, it's very important that the relationship is always between you and I, the goals and concerns. And where the gap often occurs in our industry is that there isn't a connection between your lawyers and accountants, and also using our in-house tax specialist or estate planning specialist to help you. So I'm really the go-between all of those channels. And many people, if they're going to have a synchronized plan, when I talk to accountants, it's shocking how many times when I ask them, how many clients of yours, this is the accountant, do you get to see their personal financial plan and know what's going on? And almost 100% of them say never. So if we're all working for the benefit of you, then we should really be making sure that we're utilizing all of the specialists that you have and the other professionals, particularly lawyers and accountants when needed. So again, I'd like to remind you that you have an opportunity to ask questions in the chat, and I am able to see them, and I am able to either deal with them or right now, or either as we're going along. So the agenda today is real simple. We're going to talk about some current market conditions. We're going to talk about the importance of staying the course. And I do want to congratulate you. I have literally had one phone call. I do continue to get emails and requests. And as I'm talking to people, they think I'm being inundated. No, literally, I've had one phone call where the person really was very concerned and very panicked. I'm not saying people aren't concerned, but I'm saying I've only spoken to one person that was really, truly panicked, and which is phenomenal. So we're going to go through some of the government benefit programs, whether it be individual or businesses, and then I'll also attempt to take questions as we go through. So let's get going. All right. So I'm going to do a global market update, and I'm going to start off with a poll. This will be my second poll. So again, wish me luck on this. And I'm curious to know how you're feeling. Off we go. I'll give this about 30 seconds as well. Okay, excellent. Yeah, so I will share the results a little bit later. How's that? Right? It's really interesting, and it's good to see that we sort of cover the gamut here. And actually, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to share it now. Why don't I? Let's have a look. So about 8% are really concerned about the swings in the market, and I understand that would be the case. Others, I'm nervous, but doing okay so far. So that's about 50%. And I completely, again, understand that because there has been an extreme level of volatility. 13% said they're not worried at all, but focusing only on their long-term goals. And those are people that have probably been through a few market events with me over the timeline. And 29% see this as a buying opportunity. And that's very interesting. Thank you for doing this. And we might look at this a little bit later as well. So onwards and upwards. In order to understand the future, we have to understand the past. So let's just quickly look at what happened. So on December 31st, as it was in China, they identified that there was a new virus that had affected dozens of people. And by the end of January, the virus that was known as COVID-19, and my understanding is the 19 represents the year of its discovery, had spread throughout the world. And it led to the lockdown of Wuhan, as we know, which is a city of more than 11 million people. And by early March, the governments around the world were beginning to realize that this was a very severe virus, and they took immediate action. And for many of you, as you know, our daughter was going to university in Milan, so we've been very much at the front line of this as we're going through. Now, while these events were starting to take place, global equity markets started to decline, and it first started at a benign place, and then it rapidly picked up speed. And as you can imagine, in a very, very short period of time, as you witnessed, the North American markets in particular were well down over 37-38% in an extremely short period of time, which is something that is very unique to this situation. So around the world, people are asking really basic, important questions. How many people can contract this? How serious is it? How long will it last? What measures will governments take? And more importantly, and the question that still is out there today, is how will this affect the economy? So this uncertainty will always, always push markets tumbling because they do not understand uncertainty. They need answers. Whether the answer is bad, it is irrelevant. Markets always seek answers, and they're also forward-looking. This is what we call a bear market, when markets have fallen more than 20%. So where are we now? Well, countries have around the world taken to flattening the curve. It's a phenomenal experience. It's a phenomenal amount of information that is being shared around the world. And what they're doing is they're recommending people to stay home and to self-isolate. And certainly in many countries around the world, that was very difficult to do. And we have seen the results of that. But for those countries that have been lagging in getting the coronavirus into their country, they have been able to, I think, probably self-isolate on a steeper level. So there are certainly signs of optimism in China. They've opened up Wuhan completely now. Factories are working. I have some other information on that. But markets are still going to remain volatile without question, because until there's full answers, we can expect volatility. And by the way, as many of you have spoken to, we enjoy volatility. As a matter of fact, volatility is one of the most important instruments if markets are working effectively. And it's something that we actually thrive in, because under the category of buy low and sell high, you have to have both. And so for us to provide value and to increase the quality of portfolios, we do require volatility and certainly opportunities. So governments around the world and the financial institutions, including the World Bank, they had lessons back in 2008. They created fail-safes that they didn't think they'd have to use again, but they learned from those lessons. And they're also now implementing them. So they're making sure that there is no credit freeze. In 2008, please understand, that was a financial crisis. The banks of the world were literally locked up, and nobody within probably 2 to 3 days was going to be able to get money. And that's why they did what they did. And so we are definitely not in a situation like that. The banks today are extremely, extremely liquidified. I didn't turn my phone off, sorry. Also, all countries are taking immediate action to not only provide capital and liquidity to the markets, liquidity meaning access to money for companies, for individuals, and banks in particular, but also they're providing what we call fiscal stimulus. These are tax measures, spending measures, etc. Now, I'll talk a little bit more about that. So what is it that we can expect? Well, we know that it's going to continue to spread around the world. It is a flu, and flus don't dissipate immediately. Flus take time. They also rebound. And so the question is not will it, the question is how much will it be, and how big will the rebound be? But also, what steps will be taken into place as far as vaccinations go, and as far as understanding social distancing, and probably not going to work or out into the community if you are sick. Market volatility will remain without question. If there's one thing that's been absent over the last probably 15 months was market volatility. So the fact that there is back to volatility was not an unexpected event, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. But governments will continue to provide economic stimulus to their benefit, for the benefit of individuals. And for those long-term investors, and by long-term, I mean really people that are looking out more than about 1 year at this point, they're seeing tremendous value without question. And I'll give you an example of that. You know, Disney shares fell by over 50% in about 3 weeks. Without question, Disney makes a lot of their money, not only from their parks, but they also have a high cost of operation of their parks. Where they're making their money today is using technology through a new app that they call Disney. And they just went over 50 million subscribers. These are paid subscribers. And the cost of running that compared to a Disneyland is extremely low, and the profitability is very high. So with the stimulus provided by the governments around the world, we're seeing a lot of loosening of the credit. And what we're hoping is that individuals will help flatten the curve. And certainly in British Columbia, I think we've been doing a great job of that. So what else is it that we can expect? And I made some notes here. And again, it's a bit of an unfair advantage because I'm the one that gets to talk and you have to sit there and watch. So again, you're all nodding your head. here's what this is personal beliefs. These are things that I think that we can definitely expect. Not only are there going to be technological advances, because when any time that there is some kind of crisis and a need, the number one place that we can count on today is technology. And so there's so many technology advances happening and smart machine learning, but there's also collaborations happening in the healthcare industry, in the communication industry, how information is being shared. Unfortunately, as many of you know, there's a key term out there called fake news, and that's not new. The news hasn't been running under fake news for some time, or has been running under that prospect. We have to make sure that we all understand that news agencies today are profit industries. They're made for profit. Their job is to try to keep you tuned in, logged in, or focused, or listening as long as possible, because their only single revenue stream is advertising. So the longer that they keep you on, if they can keep you watching their advertising, so they'll say things like, as they go to commercial break, stay tuned, frog eats gorilla. And then, you say, no way, and you stay, and you half listen to those commercials. But the more that they can show viewership, the more that they can charge, they are for profit. Therefore, the more sensationalized that they can be, then therefore their profits will expand. I'm not saying that it's all incorrect, but I'm saying please understand, right? A couple things that I wanted to note is that, I don't know if you're aware, but yesterday Apple and Samsung have come together. Again, I'm going to say that Apple and Samsung, two of the largest competitors in the cell phone and technology marketplace today, Apple and Samsung. They have collaborated. And what they've collaborated is, by mid-May, they're going to be providing you with an opportunity to allow approval and to download an app that will share your information where you are at all times with the current health board. So every time that a person is diagnosed with the coronavirus and they report it to the health agencies, they will be able to look back over 14 days and to know if you've ever come into contact with that person, and to know if you should self-isolate. And therefore, every person that you've talked to over those period where you may have been providing the coronavirus to somebody and sharing it without knowing, that will immediately, you will receive a text message. This is how fast technology is changing. This is how fast that we're able to communicate. And by end of May, they expect that they will then be able to have that already built in, and all you have to do is provide approval and you will not have to download an app. So I know that we're always talking about what if, and what if things don't change, and what does the future not look like? We cannot discount technology, particularly in the healthcare field. Another area, I think, that I don't know if it's being discussed, but I just wanted to talk about with technology today, and I never thought that we would ever see this, is that in combination with the World Health or Health Organization and all of the health agencies within each province, state, and country, more than 50 of the world's leading healthcare communities and also research centers, colleges, universities, and experts around the world are collaborating in real time in order to find, maybe not a vaccination, because we know that that will take time, but to find something that if a person is infected with the coronavirus before it gets too bad, that there is something that will stop it at where it is, or at least alleviate the pressures, and it will not allow it to go into their lungs. So in constant discussion with the people that are helping manage your money from around the world, the one thing that they do say consistently is that they believe that people are going to be surprised at how fast that will be coming, because they know, and they're talking in real time to companies literally 24 hours a day. There's going to be changes in consumer behavior. We're already seeing that, of course. There's what I call inflection points. Inflection points are where we can look back in time and go, things changed at that point. And I think we're in one of those. And I think technology is going to be the basis of that. And also, I think social sharing as well. As far as the economies go, without question, anytime that there's a recession, weaker companies will disappear. And, larger companies that are funded through high cash flow will survive, and new industries will form. There will be changes to how things are done for the future, and that will be in grocery, travel, manufacturing, and many others. There will be loss of jobs, but there will also be retraining and repurposing that will come out of that, as it does every recession. So just want to keep going on here. So the most important things that you can do now to help protect your retirement paycheck, if you're retired and taking your paycheck, is you have to have a plan and stick to it. We know that we built you a financial plan for a reason. We want to make sure that you have proper diversification. And I'm going to go through some things with that as well. When we're investing, we are investing for the long term. And by long term, I'm not talking 30 years. I'm talking through now to really the end of your life. So we want to also be determining what is your proper income withdrawal rate. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about that. And more importantly is take financial advice. Understand that professionals are taking care of you from behind the scenes all the time. And this isn't just myself. This is lawyers, accountants, doctors, et cetera, right? And dentists, because I know that a few of them are on the line today too. So I wanted to show you, I wasn't sure which video I wanted to show you. So this is where it might get a little bit clunky. So please give me an opportunity here to share a different screen. And let's see. I want to make sure that, okay. I'm going to turn my phone on, Bernard, if you can give me a thumbs up that this is playing.
Hello, I'm Herb Lamba, Senior Vice President, Financial Services at IG Wealth Management. During volatile times in the marketplace like today, it's important to have proper insights and perspectives in order to ensure we make the best decisions at the right time. I'm very excited to introduce Bill Chornis, Senior Vice President, Investment Strategy. Bill brings over 30 years of experience in global capital markets to his role. Bill presents at many corporate conferences and events in addition to external financial organizations. He has a diploma in business administration and is a chartered financial analyst charter holder.
Thanks, Herb. For the last 11 years, we've been enjoying one of the longest economic expansions and biggest bull markets in history. But it didn't seem clear on March 9, 2009. On March 9, 2009, the S&P 500 was down by 50%, and the belief was that capitalism had failed. The evidence was that we were using taxpayer dollars to bail out the global financial system, so essentially socializing it. If you go back and you take a look at what the forecast for the future was, it was decidedly bleak, as it was believed that economies couldn't grow for many years to come, and ergo the stock market could not have any upside performance. As you can see from the chart on the right, the forecast was completely wrong, as the S&P 500 from that date is up over 350%. That said, I believe that there is a residual hangover from that event from individual and professionals alike. They've never recovered. They're constantly looking back at that event, waiting for the next shoe to drop. Since March 9, 2009, investors have lived in a constant fear of the next crisis, some of which I've listed here, certainly not an exhaustive list by any means. But we've had a Grexit, we've had a Brexit, we've had a fiscal cliff. We've had many, many events that at that moment in time looked like what might be permanent barriers to future financial success. But in each one of these instances and many others, the first reaction of the stock market is to go down, and then it takes a period of time to recover. And over this cycle, it has continued to reach new highs after each one of these events has occurred. For those who had a globally diversified portfolio, since December of 2008, as evidenced here, they've had an extraordinarily good market return. The S&P 500 total return in Canadian dollars has compounded annually at 15.3%, the MSCI World at 12.5%, MSCI Europe at 9%, and Canada 9% in round numbers. If I had a portfolio that had allocated 25% of my equity exposure to each one of those buckets, I would have had period. Very, very good in a very low inflation environment. The larger issue is very few got those rates of return. This slide is evidence that many did not participate in that biggest bull market in history. What we're looking at is cash flows into equity and fixed income funds in the United States. And you can see that since 2008, equity funds, without exception, have been in net redemption over the entire period of time. I believe that that is a huge cost of opportunity lost that in many cases might not be recoverable. I refer to this period of time as the most hated bull market in history. As you can see on the slide, in 2008, 65% of Americans had direct exposure to the US stock market. Today, it's 52% and falling. It's the lowest in the last 40 years. And what's interesting about this chart is that the participation rates have continued to decline throughout the biggest bull market in history. No one can accurately predict where the stock market's going to go in the short run, and this slide is the proof. Those blue bars you're looking at, those are the consensus forecasts from Wall Street going back to 2001. So let's just look at the far left side, 2001. The consensus for expected return that year in the stock market was for about 11 or 12%. The red dot is what actually happened. It went down 12%, not even close. As you can see on the chart, the red dot never lands on the blue bar, so the forecast is never right. If you take a look at 2013, that's the year coming out of the fiscal cliff. The expected return that year for the S&P 500 was about 2 or 3%. It actually went up 32% or 41% in Canadian dollars. I mentioned earlier that the cost of opportunity lost might not be recoverable. And it's because in those years that you have very, very large returns, you have to be there for them. And nobody can forecast which years those are. And now we're experiencing a new exogenous shock called the coronavirus. And the question is, as captured by The Economist, how bad will it get? And I offer that not only in the context of a healthcare scare, but also how bad will it get in the stock market? Recently, we've been experiencing a tremendous amount of volatility in the stock market. So I wanted to present a short-term model of how we try to look at the world. Basically, at the top of the chart, what's going on in the economy? And what happens in the general economy influences a business's ability to generate an economic profit. All businesses are valued essentially over the long term on the profits that they generate. The more money they make, essentially, the more valuable the business, and that value is just simply reflected in the stock market. As the market goes up, it creates wealth. We go out, we spend that wealth, generating a positive impact on the economy, and we're in a virtuous circle until something upsets it. Typically, what upsets it is an exogenous event. Something by design cannot be forecasted. And what that has to do with the stock market is it creates uncertainty. Right now, because of quarantines, business closures, supply chain disruptions, investors collectively are very, very uncertain as to what is the short, medium, and long-term impact on the economy. Without knowing that, it's very, very hard to determine what corporate profits will be in the future. And that's what creates underlying volatility in the stock markets. So I think we should expect that volatility to continue, at least over the short run, until more information becomes available where investors can then take and apply it to that basic model and say, okay, we now have some confidence of what the profit picture looks like going forward, and we can reprice stock market risk effectively. What you are looking at on this slide is corporate profits generated at the index level by the S&P 500 on the left and the TSX on the right. The blue bars are the annual profits generated, earnings per share, each year going back to 2000. The red bar is a consensus forecast for the coming year. That red bar, the only thing we know about it is, as a consensus, it is probably wrong. But directionally, we see that profits, at least at this point, are still expected to grow. Over the last 20 years, X 2008-2009 on the S&P 500, profits have hit new historical highs every year. So by extension, it would make sense that the stock market, as a reflection of those corporate profits, would continue to be closer to its highs. On the right, you can see that the profit pool on the Canadian stock market is more volatile, as the Canadian stock market is heavily influenced by commodity cyclicals such as oil and gas, copper, zinc, nickel, and gold. But in terms of trend over the last 20 years, you can see that the profit pool has achieved new historical highs as well. This slide shows the interrelationship between earnings and the stock market. The red line is a quarterly earnings per share delivered by the S&P 500, and the blue line is the index level itself. And you can see that over long periods of time, those two lines are highly correlated. Earnings drive price ultimately in the stock market. This chart goes back and takes a look at any number of economic expansions over time, and then shows how many corrections, as defined by an 8% drawdown and a 15% drawdown, happened over those various expansions. The correction that we're recently experiencing in terms of magnitude is very, very much in line with past corrections. The difference this time is it has happened in a very, very short period of time. That said, they are a part of a normally functioning market. This slide presents what I call the 70% advantage. What you're looking at is a calendar year return, year by year, ranked by ranges of return, 0 to 10, 10 to 20, 0 to minus 10, and so on, going back to 1926. 75% of the time, as you can see on this chart, you get a positive experience in the stock market. If you go to the far left side, you can see in 2008, the point of maximum pessimism, if you will, the death of capitalism, a range of returns of minus 30 to minus 40. Conversely, look at the right side of the chart. In 2009, coming out of the death of capitalism, the range of returns in 2009 of 20 to 30%. 75% of the time, the stock market goes up. That is your advantage in the stock market over a reasonable period of time. So for the past 92 years, the stock market has provided a positive rate of return on a calendar year basis 75% of the time. Pretty good odds. The chart you're looking at is the calendar year returns on the S&P 500 going back to 1980. There's a lot of data here, so let's just deal with the far left-hand side, for example, 1980. In 1980, calendar year 1980, the stock market went up 26%. Pretty good year. But what that red dot is below it is the inter-year decline of 17%. So think about what happened here. As the market begins a new year in 1980, obviously, it must have started to accelerate to the positive, and it goes up for a while, and then it rolls over, starts to go down, and everybody has a different threshold of pain. And it goes down 5, 6, 7%, and all of a sudden we're reading about Brexit or Grexit or fiscal cliffs, and we become concerned. At some point, as it goes down to, let's say, 12, 13%, we believe that we should extricate ourselves from the market. This is fun with math only, but on that red dot, down 17%, if you got out of the market on that day, your cost of opportunity was 40%. Because if you put a dollar in on that day, you got a 40% return. That's how you win. You cannot achieve your long-term goals in the stock market by consistently crystallizing losses every time it goes down. The important thing to note on this chart is those red dots. That every year, without exception, at some point during the year, there is a negative rate of return achieved. It's how you deal with that event that will determine how financially successful you are over time.
Thanks, Bill, for those valuable insights. It's times like these that really reinforce the importance of having a personalized financial plan like the IG Living Plan that you've developed with your consultant. The plan focuses on your long-term success and avoids getting caught up in the emotional noise that's currently in the marketplace. Part of that plan is having a customized investment portfolio that meets your goals and risk tolerance that, as Bill mentioned, is also globally diversified. That is exactly how our managed solutions are designed. Within these solutions, we have some of the best and brightest sub-advisors from around the world managing the investments on your behalf. Our world-class advisors are looking at ways to both minimize risk and capitalize on opportunities within the portfolios. It's important to stay the course and let our team of experts do what they do best. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to reach out to your IG Wealth Management consultant. Thank you.
Oh, sorry. There. You got to watch me look confused. How was my face? Yeah. I didn't really sweat. Huh? I'm hoping that you can all see this now. Thank you. Again, just learning to use Zoom, it's definitely deeper than other programs, but also has its own complexities. And I hope you enjoyed that video. Those are two great friends of mine. Just a moment. Let me just check if everybody can hear me. I'm getting some messages. Right, so just go into the chat room, please, if you have any questions. Oh, I got a thumbs up. Okay, thank you very much. Yeah. So again, yeah, a little bit clunky, jumping between videos and such. It is my first time. I want to be doing this obviously more. Does take some time to make sure. I just found out I was just actually chatting with Herp, who was the introductor and completion of that video, just while you were watching it. And he was letting me know that it's 0 degrees in Winnipeg. So what I also wanted to let you know, those are two very close friends of mine that I'm in contact with all the time. Some of you will have met both. Some of you will have met one or the other. But Bill has been with us for well over 30 years, and he is considered one of the top in the game without question. So I hope you gathered some great information from that. We do have literally some of the best possible people in the world working on your portfolios at all times. And the one thing that we do know is that when markets fall, they fall steeply and they fall quickly. And that's for a few reasons. Sometimes they're known, meaning that there's a slow moving train coming, like a recession. And other times there's what we call an exogenous event like this that nobody saw coming to the depth and breadth. And until there's knowledge, then the markets tend to, you know, continue to fall. Now, what you have seen over the last week is that the U.S. markets in particular had their best week since 1974, the oil embargo, OPEC oil crisis, they call it. Now, the reason for that is really quite simple. It's because there's three things that have been happening. One is that over the last 2 weeks is that the governments have come to plate in all areas around the world. So people are feeling, knowing that they're supported, companies are going to be supported. And again, I mean, we know that because of a recession, but also there is some timeline starting to emerge, because as we're seeing the coronavirus go through communities, they are starting to either peak or slow down in their new cases. And the third is that simply when markets have fallen as much as they had, the opportunities were too high. And so that's why you're starting to see markets rebound. One thing I do want to let you know is that markets in general, they recover or start their recovery about 3.8 months before recession's bottom. And the reason for that is because markets are so forward-looking. So when they don't know what's coming in the future, that's why they will fall. But they're so forward-looking that the news continues to get bad while the markets start to go up, albeit choppily, but they start to go up. And that is why most people tend to miss that if they try to exit the market. They're waiting for the news to get good. But by then, they've usually missed up the largest upside, as shown in this graph today. Certainly, the upsides are continuously significantly better than the downsides. So when we build you a financial plan, in particular when it comes to looking at your income, what this chart shows is that if somebody had $100,000 at age 65 and they had a moderate conservative portfolio, and that moderate conservative portfolio was taking a 5% income, and we use all kinds of metrics for this in order to come up with these solutions. These are not random. These are solutions that we use, and they're very detailed. But if somebody took, on a simple terms, they had $100,000 nest egg, they took a 5% income, so they had a 5% average rate of return, literally their money would last until age 89, so, you know, almost 25 years. So we wouldn't have any concern. But we also know that that isn't the reality, meaning if we just take simply a computer and we juggle, then we just use complete linear metrics, it's very easy to say this. But this is where plans fail. Plans fail because you have to take into account, and if you did see my video, I talked about this, what we call sequence of returns and how important that is. Somebody could have a 5% average long-term rate of return in a conservative portfolio, but if that's the case, what it doesn't take into account is that in the early years, maybe it went straight up and then later there was a market fall. What if at the very beginning there was a market fall before it started to recover? That sequence in itself will have a dramatic difference over how a portfolio performs over time and how long the income will last. And I will give you an example. Over the last 2 weeks, We brought in several new clients that reached out to us. We did it all virtually like this. And in each and every case, every one of them, and I'm talking millions of dollars, every one of them had portfolios that were 80 to 90% alone in Canada, high energy index, and typically were in the area. The worst case I saw had 23 stocks and the next one had 31 stocks. That was the limit. So the one portfolio had 23 stocks in it, and the best portfolio for diversification, again, it was about 85% Canadian, had 31 stocks. What happened is as the stock market fell by 37%, so did they. I don't know how long the recovery will be, but what they didn't have is diversification. And that is why we diversify your portfolios. When we're using these portfolio solutions for you, you have in the neighborhood of 1,000 to 14, 1,500 stocks, depending on the risk of that portfolio. That's why you have seen your portfolios decline, but nowhere near to the market level. And that's why when we're building your plan, this won't happen. If we don't take into account diversification and a portfolio follows this pattern, they may have the same 5% rate of return as an average over time, but their experience is extremely different and you will run out of money. Therefore, you need to know that we build this into your plan on purpose. It's called a Monte Carlo. I will run upwards of 1,000 different parameters and scenarios, throwing all kinds of volatility in there. And when I know that that works, then the plan works. And that's how we decide on your retirement income. And I think it's important to know that. And for people that are dealing with, and I won't say it, that are dealing with these limited diversified portfolios, having this level of volatility is what will hurt you for the future. And we're taking care of that. This is the example of just showing you that portfolio diversification. So we've spent a lot of time understanding what your risk tolerance is, whether it be conservative all the way up to aggressive. And we're utilizing what was 18 of the best companies in the world. Now it's up to 21. And they're working together 24 hours a day to help balance the portfolio. And on the far right, you're actually seeing real results from these portfolios up to March 31st. So the very dark bottom green line and the brown line represents the U.S. stock market, that is the brown, related in Canadian dollar terms, and then the Toronto Stock Exchange. So by the end of March, they had fallen by, call it 20 to 22%. The managed risk portfolios, right, and the core portfolios on a medium risk basis fell less, well, just right around half of that. That means that their point of recovery is also very rapid, because as I showed you in the previous slide, and I don't know if you can see my mouse, but if a portfolio does this, it takes a very long time to recover. If a portfolio only does this, they also then recover very quickly, and therefore it does not interrupt long-term retirement plans. As you know, I've been doing this for 26 years, and I have not had a retirement plan fail because I stick to the science. I wanted to talk a little bit about the government programs, and I congratulate you if you're staying awake. If you haven't got up to get coffee, I'm equally impressed. I have to say it's one of the strangest experiences I've had, because I don't have anybody to look at. So I'm just looking at a camera. And so again, I'm looking for some feedback later. I do have a sign to identify. I found that out in dealing with new clients that were being referred to us. What they found is that they didn't have a financial plan first and foremost. So for them, it was just about portfolio, and that isn't the answer. But I had no way of actually identifying myself. So that's why we were able to get the sign. I'm just going to jump out again here, and I'm going to try sharing some different documents with you, because I think this is going to be a little bit easier. I had some screens that were made there. Can you see that okay? I'm going to make this. So the government today has come to the plate in every way possible. I've never seen anything like this. I'm sure nobody has seen anything like this. Everybody's concern is, they've spent so much. But let's put it into perspective. What happens is that the governments of the world go to, if it's a democratic country, they go to, in our case, the House of Commons. And what they say is, they say, we need to do something to help our economy fiscally. And so we need you to give us a line of credit, basically. And so in Canada, they gave them a $82 billion line of credit. And they said, this is what you are allowed to spend. Now let's make sure we spend it prudently. It doesn't mean they're going to spend that. It means that that is what they're allowed to do. It is very confidence inducing. And again, this is why the markets are performing, is because they understand that the governments are there to back them. Now, what they've also said is that if they need to, they will go back and ask for more money, because until there's an end to this, that may have to happen. So you can see for the Canadian Emergency Wage Subsidy, this is very important. So companies used to have to prove that they had dropped 30% in revenue. Now they've dropped it to 15%. This is now open for application. They've also done a temporary small business subsidy. Again, think about this. In Canada, we have more small businesses than almost any other country out there. And with these small businesses, if they're the ones that are the employers, they're the ones that are continuing to hire. So what they're saying is don't lay off your people. Let's keep them going, right? So they're able to pay for 75% of employees. My family falls into that case as well. My older kids that are working, especially the ones that have summer jobs that were already hired. So they're continuing to be paid because the government is covering up 75% of that. The government's going to be increasing credit also for small businesses. So if you had a payroll of over $50,000 last year, you're able to, through your financial institution today, apply for a business credit availability up to $40,000. Now, there's some tremendous sides to that. So you have until 2021, to start paying that back, all interest free. And if you haven't, I have to look at this myself, but I haven't looked that deeply, but I understand that that $30,000 will be amortized after that, after the year 2021. Very, very helpful. A lot of support for farmers. Work sharing programs, people that have under EI, we have to make sure that they're covered. Child tax credits are also being gifted, so they're being increased. Also, disability tax credits are also being increased. I'm just going to have a quick look now as well to also some provincial measures. Again, I understand it's a little bit clunky, but I'm just working my way through it. Oh, this is the Canadian Education Response. Yeah. So in BC, before I get into this, but in BC, there we go. Yeah, in British Columbia, we have done quite a few things. People can have relief on their hydro bills. They can have relief on their Fortis bills. So again, the provincial government is also stepping up to the plate. On a personal level, the one thing they haven't talked about is student aid and student programs. If people apply to have a student working in their company, and the deadline was February 20th, then the government says that they will now pay 100% of that student's wage as long as it's the minimum wage. So those students will be able to continue to work. But what they're doing is they're also offering and opening that up on a case-by-case basis so that students will be able to continue to work and so that they can still fund their post-secondary education. I believe that when it comes to the student loans, they've also, right now, they've also made them interest-free loans and pause payments. As you know, you can pause payments on mortgages and also car loans and lines of credit, what have you. You should know that banks are working that does not affect your credit rating. They have taken care of that now. But the EI and the Canadian Emergency Response Benefit was the first thing that they talked about. And there you can see a sheet that we have put together. So everybody, if they fall into this category, will be able to receive $2,000 per month. Now, while that is likely not enough for some people, but that's why if you have children, childcare is being is staying open, by the way, and the government is funding childcare 100%. I know that because we're on the board of the Y, and as you can imagine, we're going through shutdowns. But the one area that continues to thrive is the childcare facility, as people are working from home and if they have young children. So they're also going to receive an extended child tax benefit if they're eligible. I can send you this information if you send me a quick email asking for these documents, and I will be able to send them your way. And I think first and foremost, what we can agree on is that there is a tremendous amount that is happening in the world today. I also wanted to quickly show you, for those people that are using the iProfile program, what the iProfile also looks like. I don't know if you're able to see that. If it's the right size. I'm just going to scroll down. Let's see if I can make that a little bit smaller so you can see it on your screen. I think it looks okay. So here's what the iProfile portfolios are looking like. Again, these are private pool portfolios. Here you can see the green and the gray, and that represents the S&P 500 and represented in Canadian dollars, and also the green represents the Canadian, right? So you have a conservative portfolio here down by about 6%. This is on March 31st. Please understand that they've improved tremendously since then. And you can see from a risk. So this is a conservative portfolio, moderate conservative. The black is moderate, moderate aggressive. And the most aggressive portfolio, which is 100% stock ownership, fell still only, literally only two-thirds of what the market fell. And that's from quality and active business measurement. And what they will do is they're also recovering at a very, very important rate. Now, I just had a message, and I think it's important, is that when it comes to the $40,000 tax loan or potential business loan that is being provided, the business loan in itself, and I'll go back to that screen, the business loan in itself is only eligible for those businesses that had T4 income in 2019. So many business owners will only take dividends, or if they had staff, they maybe only had dividends as well. My understanding is that there is a workaround right now, because what they're trying to determine is what kind of gap is in there at this time. And I do expect that that will change. I think that we're going to continue as we go through this, and there is no timeline, as we know, but as we go through this, things that won't change are is spending, consumer spending. It just may be on what we spend it on. I have been getting a lot of emails from you, especially after talking with you. I'm trying to talk with everybody, of course, but it does take time. And also the people that have called in or asking just to talk, I appreciate it, because what we're talking about is, you know, the first and foremost is, I think the thing that I get from everybody is they always ask how I'm doing. And I appreciate that. It's hard for everybody. And certainly as we're spending 3 weeks inside or not being able to share, but it does, for me, it is definitely bringing family together, unlike that we've probably been able to do for a while. We've really adapted quickly to working from home. I am having virtual meetings using a different program called Zoom. Microsoft Teams. It's very simple, able to share our screen. I'm able to go through your financial plan very easily. We can go through your accounts and go through any information, just like seeing each other, except it is virtual. And I suspect that may become something that people are comfortable with for the future. So I'm just going to jump out of that and try to go back to my presentation. So wish me luck. I had written down all of the government programs. As you can see, I spent a fair bit of time doing this. The problem was this was as of April 1st, and then they changed them all again April 8th. And for all I know, they changed them today because we do have a prime minister that is speaking every morning, and almost every day he's coming out with some type of alteration or changes to this. So therefore, I didn't use it because it's changed. One of the questions is around RIF income. For those clients that are taking a retirement income fund, they do have an opportunity to reduce the minimum amount now by 25%. This is in place. We have been doing this for clients that have requested it. We don't have a lot of information about repayment, et cetera, at this time. But for those people that are taking an income that they don't feel they need, why take it out of your portfolio if you don't have to, from a retirement income fund or a life income fund? And we are able to reduce that now. So simply just send me an email if that is something that you would like to do, for those that have. And for those that haven't, it's certainly a consideration. I know personally, as a family, we're spending significantly less than what we normally would do. Now we're getting to the end. If there's any questions, let me summarize. One of the most important things that you need to understand is that I build you a financial plan. And as I build a financial plan, we have to make sure that we're not focusing just on portfolios. Portfolios are a component of a financial plan, but we have to make sure, though, is that your withdrawal rates are accurate, that your tax planning is very important, that we're managing your cash flow, because ultimately that is going to help you have business success or optimize your retirement. And if we don't synchronize all of these inside your living plan, then we're not going to have the desired outcome. And so that's why we have to make sure, unlike the people that have just transferred in, where it was just focus on portfolios, we've been able to put together proper diversification for them, proper tax planning, provide them proper optimal income for life, and they have comfort on that. As you know, I have a financial planning process that I go through, and I use it consistently. I don't ever change. I use it 100% of the time. Two things you should know. One is that I have a plan, and two is that I stick to it. I wanted to read you a quick article, and I can send you this. This is an article that it was an interview with Warren Buffett. I won't read it all. I'm just going to highlight a few things. It says, you know, one of the most important perspectives you can have is from Warren Buffett. So I just wanted to go through a few points. So Warren Buffett, back in 2008, by the way, his Berkshire Hathaway was getting pummeled. And so this was an interview that was done with him. And this is really what he said. He said, let's look back at this. He said, let's look back just to Canada alone. He said, the 1950s featured the Korean War, the beginning of the Cold War, and two U.S. recessions. Canadian stocks averaged a compound annual growth rate of 13.2% over the decade. The 1960s brought the assassination of a U.S. sitting president, John F. Kennedy, civil rights leader Martin Luther King, and presidential candidate and Senator Robert Kennedy. There were race riots, the Vietnam War, unrest, and war in the Middle East, and another two U.S. recessions. The Canadian stock market generated a 10% annualized rate of return over that decade. The 1970s were brutal. The Vietnam War killed the American economy. There was double-digit inflation and stagflation. There was an oil crisis. During the tragic and frightening FLU crisis, terrorism struck again on Black September at the 1972 Olympics. The 444 days of the Iran hostage crisis began. Oh, and the Canadian stocks averaged an annual return of 10.4% over the decade. The 1980s were characterized by political unrest in Quebec, spurring a referendum. The U.S. president was shot. There was massive inflation, global recessions, a high unemployment in the U.S. and Canada. Interest rates were sky high. Your mortgage rate exceeded 20%, and then Mount St. Helens blew up. There was a massive earthquake in San Francisco, and Canadian stocks averaged 12.2% per year over the decade. Now, the 1990s had the first Iraq War, the U.S. savings and loan meltdown, the junk bond collapse, a U.S. credit crunch, the Japanese recession, which 20-year recession, I might add, and an Asian financial crisis, crippling strikes throughout Europe, the breakup of the Soviet Union, and subsequent economic depression, and fear of the impending doom of Y2K. And as for the Canadian stock market, well, it climbed an average of 10.6% per year that decade. As far, the 2000s have been exactly what you'd expect if you're a student of history. There's been tumult, upheaval, war, stupidity, greed, bad judgment, Britney Spears. Oh, the humanity. And yet we fumble on. We push on. We aspire. We stay open for business and we grow. How will returns look at the end of this decade? That's anyone's guess, but there's a lot of guessers. Since the answer lies out there in the unknowable future, we'll just have to wait and see. But if you're tempted to listen to the many opinions offered by the media, the pundits, and yes, your own gut, you may want to remember the considered thoughts of the world's richest man and its very wealthiest investor. In the long run, it's just not smart to sell us short. That's from October 2008. I pulled it out. Don't think things have changed. So anyway, I just wanted to pass that along. Now, if you have any questions at all, if you open up the chat area and let's see if there's any questions that I can help take care of. I don't think I can unmute your microphones very easily. So I think we'll maybe just skip that at the moment. But if you have any questions or anything, just put it into the chat and I'll be able to answer them. One of the questions that I have been getting as I've been talking with you is people have been asking me, first of all, they said, you know, is anybody buying? And I'll give you a very succinct answer. Over the last 10 business days, we have deposited in excess of $6.5 million for clients. So they happen to have cash, these were, you know, some new clients transferring in, but this is actual deposits that we've made. And because for those that have been with me for a long time, they do understand that this is a buying opportunity and they are taking advantage of it. We can't time it, but we do know that things are cheaper. And for those of you that do not have cash that is available, what you need to understand by using companies like BlackRock, which are five, you know, again, the top five of the seven largest companies in the world today, they are tremendously capitalized. They do not have any forced selling going on. They have so much cash in reserve that they're also doing the buying for you at this time. And this is the key differentiator you should understand. So even if we do not have individual cash, we are able to share that. Okay. Is there any questions at this time? Mm-hmm. Oh, we jumped out of the question from Joseph. Is there a forecast of what is expected when corporations commence reporting first quarter losses? Yeah, I would say that there is consistency in that area, particularly when you're dealing with companies, again, like I say, a BlackRock or Wellington or JP Morgan, et cetera. You know, they have 100% communication in real time with these companies. And they're also using intense computer technologies. And, as I mentioned, they're monitoring regularly, cell phone tracking, cell phone usage. They have satellites around the world watching where people are going all the time. And so they're able to see in real time what is happening. But more importantly, they have real time access through their computers in order to make sure that they can always be in touch with what's happening with companies. So again, they're actually providing, and a company like BlackRock is actually providing information to some of these companies in real time better than they can themselves. So yes, you can be sure that first quarter profits will come in as surprises for the smaller companies. And again, most companies, in Canada, and I hate to say it, but in Canada, all companies are considered small on a world scale when it comes to investment companies compared to a BlackRock or Wellington. Traditional analysts who are waiting to get their quarterly results and to look with the papers, like, they'll be surprised and they'll either be caught with their hands behind them, or as Warren Buffett would say, they'll find out that they've been caught swimming naked as the tide went out. We don't do that. We don't wait for quarterly profit results. We know them. We know what's coming. I have privy to information, of course, I'm not able to share because it would be considered inside trading and selling. But without question, I think everybody is in line. We do know which companies are going to be having tremendous downside. The real question, though, that I think the one that people can't answer is, how long will it take a consumer, right, to come back to the show, right? Because it's consumers that are going to make the difference. Yeah, great question from John. Okay, Monte Carlo models are quite comprehensive, but have we looked at a possible unprecedented three waves of the same crisis with a compounding negative effect? Yeah, as a matter of fact, we do, John. So part of our we have two types of Monte Carlo. So there is a traditional Monte Carlo, but then we also have our own internal mechanism that we use for simulations. And that simulation shows that if there was three consecutive bear markets in a row, as a matter of fact, so three consecutive bear markets back to back to back, how would that affect the long-term planning that we've done? So to answer your question, yes. So I actually run two. I do run two probabilities. So one is the Monte Carlo, which is traditional and probably a bit older. And then we have new simulations as well, and we rely on them both. And I'm happy to share them with you at any time. Sorry, Susan, didn't mean to ignore you there. If you're feeling confident with your current cash flow and expense requirements, should you take part in some of these deferrals and assistance, even if you don't currently need them, like deferring a mortgage payment if it's available? Well, if you defer a mortgage payment, you're not deferring the interest. You are deferring the payment, but the interest will just continue to accrue. And at this stage, it will not compound. So you aren't getting out of paying it. You're just going to pay it longer. So in my opinion, you know, if you have the current cash flow and it's coming from investments that we're having to maybe redeem, I think it's a conversation that we can have in about 3 to 4 weeks time, because the reminder that I have is that right now This is about 3 weeks old for North America. And so much has changed in 3 weeks. We went from unknown to some knowns. And the next 3 weeks, I suppose, is going to also give us a lot more information that we can value. So all crises end, and they all do look back in time and say, okay, that was an inflection point. And some of the discussions that I've had with people is in order to have a reference of where we are today, sometimes it helps to also go to the future and look backwards. So if we were to go out 1 year from now and look backwards, the question I would ask is, do you see things better? Do you see people, you know, booking holidays, albeit different types of holidays? Do you see people going out and socializing, albeit in different fashions? Do you see people, being in the community and taking care of themselves, but also going back to enjoying themselves? And I would say that in all cases, most people would say yes. And even if we look 3 years out back to today, I think that we'll see a healthier world and a better world in all areas. Is there any other questions? These are great questions. Okay. Well, listen, thank you. I've been trying to stay on time. Pretty good for me. I only went 10 minutes over, right? So listen, thank you very much. And I'll send out again, please provide me with some feedback or private questions. You can reach out. Email is probably the easiest. If you call, we do get a forward from our message. And from our office, I don't know how long we'll be working from home. I think it'll be a little while longer, but I do love having the video chats with you. Let's do it more often. I certainly enjoy it. Please take care. If you have questions or concerns, reach out. But without question, one of the people asked me last week, was, you know, am I concerned about the markets? And actually, that's the last thing I'm concerned about. To be absolutely, completely frank, I have no concern about overall markets. I am concerned about certain companies, without question. There will be different industries that grow, and there'll be others that contract. And that is what happens through the evolution of all capitalism and democracy. And we just happen to be going through one in a rapid phase. So stay tuned. And again, thank you for your faith. I look forward to seeing you, and I look forward to being able to touch base with you on a one-to-one basis. If I'm not getting to you, please reach out to me. I'm not ignoring you. As you can imagine, it's just we have a lot of people to get a hold of. And I also, again, want to thank you for not keeping us a secret. The people that have been reaching out to me as referrals from you is phenomenal. Such quality people and great people, and I'm able to help them. So thank you. Okay. Sorry, one last thing from John. Just wanted to say, if you defer your mortgage payment, you're also adding interest generally, which is not a tax efficient way. He's correct. Yeah. All right. I'm going to sign off now. Have a wonderful rest of the long weekend. Happy Easter to everybody. We're having a virtual Easter egg hunt with all of the family tomorrow. So I'm looking forward to that. Take care.